Picture yourself in a boat on a river with tangerines.
Welcome back to another APUS History of Video Lecture. Today we're going to be talking about the history of the 1960s. So how do we talk about this and what is the context of it? Because this is a very controversial time in history. I think we have to start off with the baby boom generation, which has been a major highlight today in what a lot of people are talking about politically. After World War II was all done, when soldiers came back home from the war, there was a massive explosion in babies. And when that took place in that generation, we had a huge group of people growing up in a very prosperous time of United States history. It also became a time of incredible youthful idealism. In fact, the president of that time period is most known as the 1960s, John F. Kennedy. And John F. Kennedy gave his inaugural speech in which he called out and said, "What can you do for your country?" When he gave that speech, it inspired people to think about the issues of civil rights and inspired them to think about how to fight poverty. By the end of this era, there's going to be a real questioning of that idealism. There's going to be more of a questioning about whether or not there should be a high skepticism in the ability for government to be able to do the things that it wants to do, especially in being able to solve problems of inequalities. So one of the first people who's so important during this time period of the 1960s is John F. Kennedy. When John F. Kennedy was elected into the presidency, he was the youngest person ever to be elected into the presidency at that time period. Also, what's so important in understanding about John F. Kennedy was the aura that he gave. In fact, it was known as the aura of Camelot, this idea of a youthful president with a beautiful family who was attempting to reform society. Now, there's actually a reality behind all of that. It turns out that John F. Kennedy actually wasn't all that successful as a president. He didn't pass much during his time period. And a big part of that probably was due to his lack of experience. In fact, it was his vice president, Lyndon Johnson, who got far more done after John F. Kennedy, tragically, was assassinated. But one of John F. Kennedy's biggest successes came very early on. John F. Kennedy met at one point with Khrushchev, Nikita Khrushchev from the Soviet Union, in an attempt to negotiate over peace deals in the world. And he was kind of warned before he went not to go because he was so young. The argument was Khrushchev would take advantage of him when they met. And that's exactly what happened. Khrushchev basically berated him for days and took advantage of him. And at that point, Khrushchev saw an opportunity. When John F. Kennedy got back home, Khrushchev decided to place nuclear missiles on the island of Cuba. Now, to be fair, the United States actually had their own missiles just about as far away as the missiles from Cuba were to the United States. We had our nuclear missiles in the Mediterranean Sea and even closer in Turkey. All the Soviet Union really was trying to do was provide balance in this contest over nuclear weapons. However, what John F. Kennedy decided to do when it came to Cuba to uphold the Monroe Doctrine was to place a quarantine around Cuba and to demand that the Soviet Union remove its missiles. Now, it took 13 days, and during that time period, there were high tensions. But by the end of it, John F. Kennedy won that battle. And when he did, he looked incredibly influential on the global stage. After that time period, John F. Kennedy did eventually come to the conclusion that it was necessary for the United States federal government to take a much bigger effort in promoting civil rights. And so he went on television making a plea for a new civil rights bill to be passed. Tragically, only a couple weeks after that time period, he would be assassinated in Texas. The good side of that, though, that came out of that was that John F. Kennedy's martyrdom became symbolic for the next president, the vice president at that time, Lyndon Johnson, to pass two major pieces of civil rights legislation. And what's so important about that, that we should consider, is that Lyndon Johnson came from the state of Texas and had actually opposed civil rights legislation for most of the time that he was in the Senate. Lyndon Johnson would also pass during that time period a series of major pieces of legislation called the Great Society Legislation, in which he would fight poverty. And there's been a lot of controversy about the Great Society Legislation, but actually it had huge success. By the time that the Great Society Legislation was done in 1969, poverty had fallen from 30% all the way down to 13%. Now, one of the arguments oftentimes used against this is that poverty was already falling because the economy was so good in the 1960s. And that's absolutely true. But the argument the Great Society Legislation halted the decrease of poverty just isn't true. During that time period, there was a dramatic decrease. Why? Well, part of the reason was the programs themselves. Two of the biggest programs provided in the Great Society programs were healthcare insurance for the elderly, Medicare, and healthcare insurance for those who were poor, Medicaid. The 1960s is also known for civil rights. And there are two phases of the civil rights movement. This is very important. We oftentimes focus on only first phase. And the first phase was led by Martin Luther King Jr. This was a highly successful period. Martin Luther King Jr. adopted two belief systems at the time period. Mohandas Gandhi, who had led the independence movement in India, had led a nonviolent movement against the British based upon Hindu spirituality. It was based on a principle called Satyagraha. Satyagraha was the belief of finding a middle path between two extremes using nonviolence. Martin Luther King also borrowed an idea from a Christian Protestant thinker named Reinhold Niebuhr. Reinhold Niebuhr called for Christian realism, the argument that basically the world was based along the lines of power and that Christians should respond to that using nonviolence, but to demonstrate the faults of power. He combined these two together and came up with a brilliant strategy. His brilliant strategy was nonviolence, but strategic nonviolence. The idea of strategic nonviolence was to confront those who did racism, but to confront them nonviolently so that they would react with their own violence, and then to catch all of that on television, on media. And that would put guilt and moral pressure on people to make changes. And in fact, that's exactly what happened. In the case of the Montgomery bus boycott, Martin Luther King demonstrated the evils of racism on television and got people to call up their local congressman in order to demand change. Now, there was some failures for Martin Luther King as well. In Albany, there was a police chief named Laurie Pritchett. And Laurie Pritchett realized exactly what Martin Luther King was doing. And before Martin Luther King showed up to do his protest, Laurie Pritchett told his policemen, don't do any violence to these protesters. He then took Black civil rights leaders and he put them in prison, but various different prisons all over the place. In fact, he even shipped some of them out of state in the prison. Why does all that matter? Because it took away from that ability to show the evils and the violence of racism. Martin Luther King, when he lost that battle against Laurie Pritchett, realized he needed to do something quick in order to make sure that he would win. In fact, at one point, there was even a church in the local area that had young African-American girls singing at it that was blown up at that time period. Right after that, Martin Luther King made a huge decision that was very controversial in the African-American community. He actually had young children who were African-American march nonviolently up to Bull Connor's policemen. When he did that, Bull Connor said, unleash the fire hoses, unleash the dogs. But fortunately, the policemen and the fire people of that time period said, nope, this is going too far. Martin Luther King won that battle. And after he won that battle, he then took his battle to Washington, D.C., where they did the March on Washington. And most people remember this march because Martin Luther King gave an impassioned speech in which he called for African Americans to be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. Unfortunately, people don't realize is the incredible radical nature of what Martin Luther King called for next that was so important. He got two major pieces of legislation passed. The first one was the Civil Rights Act of 1964. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 did something pretty amazing that we oftentimes take for granted. For the first time in American history, we had a law that said that the federal government would stop segregation not only in public places, but in private places as well. Up until now, that had been allowed, and the argument had been private people can do what they want, even if it's discrimination. Not anymore. It was very well understood that racism was systematic. And if we allowed for these things to take place in private areas, then African Americans would be locked out of everything from jobs to owning homes to being able to just go swimming in a local pool. Then there was the Voting Rights Act of 1965. The Voting Rights Act of 1965 said that the FBI would go down and supervise local elections in states. But it did something even bigger. If a state wanted to change its local election policies, it had to submit a plan to the Congress in order to supervise this. Why does this matter? Because in our country, local elections are done by the state, not by the federal government. This was the first time that the federal government stepped in and said, if you want to make any changes, you've got to go through us first. And the reason why was because so many of these states had done things like poll taxes, registration tests, the grandfather clause. They had come up with crazy ideas of how to basically suppress votes and keep people from being able to vote. These were massive victories that Martin Luther King would have in the first phase of the civil rights movement. Then there was the second phase of the civil rights movement. And it's hard to pinpoint exactly when this gets started. The reason why is because there's a continuity that goes back before 1964. There was a young man named Malcolm Little who lived in Tennessee. His father was a Black Baptist preacher who talked about the need to return to Africa. Why? Because Black people face such intense racism from white people, he saw no other solution. And all of a sudden, at one point, Malcolm Little's father turned up dead on railroad tracks. Now, it's believed to this day that the KKK were behind this. Malcolm Little's mother, who had major mental instabilities because of what had happened, sent Malcolm Little to live with his aunt up in Harlem. Up in Harlem, Malcolm Little got into some trouble dealing with local gangs. And when that happened, he was eventually put in prison. And when he was in prison, he became converted to the Nation of Islam. The Nation of Islam is largely within America, a Black-led organization that borrows from the ideas of Islam and preaches about not only the religion of Islam, but also the need to stop systematic racism within the United States. Malcolm Little became Malcolm X. And the reason why he took on that name is that he said that the X represents the loss of heritage, the loss of that background due to slavery and segregation and Jim Crow. Eventually, Malcolm X had a huge transformation in his life in which he traveled to Mecca. And when he was at Mecca, he came to the belief that Islam was really a religion for all people, white, Black, of all races. But there was still a need to fight for social justice. In 1963, Malcolm Little, who had become Malcolm X, was assassinated by members of the Nation of Islam who were angry at many of his accusations criticizing their practices within the religion. Malcolm X's ideas were eventually picked up by a young man named Stokely Carmichael. Stokely Carmichael became the leader of SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. And SNCC argued that Black people no longer should be following this nonviolent notion, but rather a notion of self-defense and a notion of pride in their heritage and who they were, a notion of Black power. And the incidents at that time period seemed to start to prove what they were saying. For example, in 1964, there was a huge movement that took place in order to register the people to vote in Mississippi, when all of a sudden, three of those members who were working to do this just disappeared. Two of them were young Jewish men from the North, and one was an African-American. Now, eventually, they did find the bodies of all three of these men. It turned out they had all been murdered. They were Schwerner, Goodman, and Cheney. Cheney, though, had been beaten up horribly before he was murdered by members of the KKK. When a lot of African-Americans at that time period saw what was happening, they really questioned, why should we be nonviolent if this is the response that we're going to get? Another incident that happened was in 1964. In 1964, at the Democratic Convention for the next election, the Mississippi African-Americans from Mississippi formed something called the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, which they came and tried to sit in the seats of the actual party from the Democratic Party. Why? Because the party that was a part of the Mississippi, part of the Democratic Party from Mississippi was highly racist. The idea was that if they could sit down in their seats, they could show that there should not be racism anymore within the Democratic Party. Well, Lyndon Johnson pulled them into a back room and said, I've got to seat these guys to get their support, but I'll promise you this. In 1968, we are going to make sure you are seated. And during this time, the Great Society programs are going to help out African Americans. Well, these young African Americans said, enough is enough. We've attempted to do this in the past. We can't just wait. You can't keep compromising with these guys. You got to kick them out of the party. Well, they were removed from the seats and they were removed from the convention. At that point, a lot of African Americans said, what are we doing? We can't put our trust in the Democratic Party because they sell us out. And the Republican Party right now is not all that interested in racial issues. They're interested in libertarianism. So they just gave up altogether on the political process and said they need to go in a much more different direction. And it just happened at that time period, there was a different direction that was forming and was forming in a lot of the cities. In a lot of urban centers, African-Americans faced huge problems that we've studied about. The issues of redlining that segregated African-Americans into the poorest parts of cities in which they lived in terrible housing, got underfunded schooling, and faced police brutality. And in the midst of this horrible environment that they were facing, they realized that Martin Luther King's strategies were not changing things quick enough. And so a number of riots began happening in these different cities. The most famous of them was the LA riots in 1964. In 1964, a young African-American was pulled over to the side of the road by a policeman for drinking in his car. And when he was pulled out, a crowd organized around. Now, you got to remember, for a lot of African-Americans at this time period, they were used to a Los Angeles police department that could be pretty abusive to African-Americans. When they saw this young man being pulled over, it led into a riot that then began for the next week. In the middle of this riot, Martin Luther King Jr. came into the riot. He stood on the top of a car in the middle of Los Angeles, pleading with people for nonviolence. And as they walked by the car, they just basically ignored him. This was an example of how things had changed. We had moved from basically civil rights phase number one, civil rights phase number two. And at the end of that civil rights phase number two in Oakland, California, a group of people came together called the Black Panthers. And the Black Panthers organized their ideas around two major philosophies. One was Marxism, and the other was the idea of social justice for African Americans. Now, when I say Marxism, I don't mean that really the Black Panthers were out for communism. In fact, they really weren't. In fact, most of the things the Black Panthers did was simply to have food programs for local poor African Americans and provide education programs for them as well. But the Black Panthers were seen by the US government as a radical organization that they had to get rid of. And in fact, the CIA established a program called COINTELPRO, in which they infiltrated the Black Panthers and destroyed them from within. So these two phases of the civil rights movement from African Americans became the model of reform movements for a whole bunch of other groups as well. Take, for example, the women's rights movement. In the early 1960s, a woman named Betty Friedan wrote a book called The Feminine Mystique, in which she talked about how women had been, through the cult of domesticity, limited to the household, and being limited to the household, they had lost the ability to have higher education, equal pay in jobs, equal types of jobs. And so because of that, there was a commission established called the Kennedy Commission on Women, which concluded at the end that women were paid far too little in comparison to men. In fact, at that time period, it was 65 cents on the dollar. On top of that, that women faced sexual harassment within the workforce and that they needed to have reproductive rights as well. By the end of the decade, though, there was a much stronger movement, a more radical movement that called for the need for reforms on cultural lines as well. In fact, this would become what is known as the third wave of feminism that questioned whether or not there was even a difference between the two genders. And in fact, in this third wave of feminism, feminists argued that there was a difference, that women were actually more compassionate, more based upon collaboration and more based upon an ability to lead, but to lead in a way in which there would be more equality. Another example of this sort of model of civil rights movement was the Chicano movement. So in the Chicano movement, we started off basically in the 1960s with a call for Hispanics to be given much better rights, especially when it comes to education, when it comes to schooling, and when it comes to housing. But by the end of the movement, there was something called the Chicano or the Brown Beret movement, in which basically Latinos of all different backgrounds came together and believed that their best bet really was to form their own ethnic identity in which they could combat what they saw as being racism, systemic racism within society. Now, this would eventually lead into a much bigger legislation issue that's going to become important for us called the Hart-Celler Act. So you might remember we talked about in the 1920s, there had been a number of immigration acts passed called the Emergency Quota Acts, which basically only limited immigration to Northern and Western European immigration. The Hart-Celler Act basically opened that up and said that there were going to be allowances for people from all over the world to be able to come. And that basically the way that that would be done is that there would be quotas set in such a way to balance off and make it fair amongst all people, so there wouldn't be racism within immigration. The very last movement that's important, that kind of, again, shows this model that we've seen, is the gay rights movement at the time period. Up until this time, there had been a number of local organizations trying to protect gay people and to promote their rights, but none of them had really taken hold until finally in 1969 at a local establishment called the Stonewall Establishment, a group of gay people were being rounded up by the police. And as they were being rounded up by the police, they took to the streets and there was this wall outside of this inn. And there they turned, they faced the police, and that was it. They said no more, and they would not go with the police at this point. And from there on out, the argument was made that homosexuals should get equal recognition. And of course, we know the story up until now, that gay people have argued also as well for equal rights in marriage and so forth. So of course, probably one of the biggest incidents of the 1960s that everybody knows about is the Vietnam War and the protest against the Vietnam War. Now, at the very beginning of the 1960s, most people were actually in favor of the United States being involved in the Vietnam War. And then in 1964, Lyndon Johnson came out and said that there had been an attack on two U.S. ships in what was called the Gulf of Tonkin up in the north of Vietnam. He made the claim that the Vietnamese had attacked these two ships, basically in international waters, and that allowed for him to call for the need for combat troops inside of Vietnam. And that's what happened. American troops went all the way up to 500,000 troops in Vietnam. Now, one of the biggest fears that American policymakers had was that we would trigger a Chinese response that would overwhelm our troops, just like it had in Korea. So instead of having ground forces go into northern Vietnam, they instead chose a strategy called Operation Rolling Thunder, where they went in and dropped bombs on North Vietnam. In fact, they dropped so many bombs, there was more bombs dropped in the entire theater of World War II, including both Europe and Southeast Asia. But none of this ended up working. Why not? Because the Northern Vietnamese, who we were fighting against at the time period, wanted their independence. They wanted their independence from the French, and now they wanted their independence from the United States. But what made matters worse was what would eventually happen in the late 1960s and early 1970s. In 1973, a group of papers came out called the Pentagon Papers. And these Pentagon Papers showed that Lyndon Johnson, when he said that those two ships had been attacked in international waters, he had lied. In fact, one of the cases, the ship wasn't even attacked really at all. And in the second case, our battleship, basically it had an error malfunction in its radar, which basically picked up what were really just thunderstorms and thought that it was an attack. At the end of this, Americans were really losing trust in their American government. It was called the credibility gap. The American government said that we were winning the war when in actuality it came out that we weren't. But the big problem that came out was with the next president. In 1969, Richard Nixon was elected into president. And when he was elected into the presidency, he came up with a policy called Vietnamization, which he said, we're going to turn the war over to Vietnam and reduce our troops. He did that. He reduced the troops from 500,000 to below 100,000. But what he wasn't honest about, and in fact lied about, was that we were bombing the nearby country of Cambodia. Now, why were we doing this? Well, because a lot of the northern Vietnamese troops realized that if they would run from Vietnam into Cambodia, they could hide out there, and America couldn't do anything about it because Cambodia was another country and it wasn't involved in the war. So Nixon bombed these areas in order to get after these northern Vietnamese troops. But then he lied to the American public and said that he wasn't doing this. When it came out that he was, there were protests across the country. And in 1973, at a local college called Kent State, a group of these protesters who were protesting nonviolently were shot upon by troops. And by the end of it, 8 college students were killed. All 8 of them ended up not even being involved within the protests. All this led to a huge distrust in the American government. And then in 1973, the Watergate scandal, in which it was discovered that Richard Nixon's advisors had broken into the Democratic headquarters during the election, that completely broke down trust within the American government. Okay, so what are our big takeaways that we can see from the 1960s? The 1960s go, I know, from 1960 to 1973. That sounds kind of strange, right? How is that possible? The reason why is because the 1960s start, number one, with a sense of youthful idealism, that the world could be changed, that we could change the world and break down all those racial barriers and economic barriers, stopping people from being unequal. Our second major takeaway, though, that comes out of this time period is that as the movements that we have talked about moved into urban centers, there were problems of poverty, police brutality, underfunding of schools that people just felt couldn't be solved. And by the end of the decade, that idealism was being lost. But probably the third and most important takeaway that we're going to see is that the government's failure to be honest during the Vietnam War and the scandals that came out at that time period would eventually turn Americans towards a much more skeptical view of their government, a much more skeptical view of idealism, and a much more skeptical view of their traditional consensus. Thanks a lot. I'll see you in class. Love is all you need. Love is all you need.